Hey, what's up everybody? BL44 coming at you with another video, alright? So, we're gonna document this particular dream because it was pretty wicked. I'd say wicked. I don't know that other people may see it as wicked, but I was more or less in the car with my mom, driving around. She was the one driving. And I'll try to rewind. I think that'll probably give me a better understanding of how to summarize this. So we were first in Oakland. It was myself in Oakland, and more or less I was having struggles of my own. Sort of like the ones I'm having in real life, financial struggles. I guess I was kind of carrying those into my dream. And I was speaking to different people that I knew there for whatever reason. I knew people that I don't know in real life. So I, you know, fragments of the dream was telling me, coming back to me right now. So like, for example, I was talking to a guy about my problems and telling him, like, you know, I might have to move up here with y'all, talking about the Bay Area, like, if things don't get better in my life, I'm gonna have to just kind of find myself up here, or, you know, I don't know where I'm gonna be. But I think I was talking to one of my aunts. Paul George was one of the people I was talking to about this. It's randomness, you know what I mean? It's always some randomness in my head. But within the dream, I found myself driving a car and then kind of going into a gutter lane to try to drive to a McDonald's. And I went to the McDonald's, ordered some type of chicken sandwich that doesn't exist. And then I found myself doing a U-turn, getting in the car, doing a U-turn, and then driving to some type of car fix up place, and once again did something illegal driving to get there. And when I got there, I think it was one of my cousins and someone else was telling me, like, you can't be driving like that, you need to get your head on straight, you can get into some real trouble, end up getting arrested. At that point, it became clear to me that I need to get some mental health help, right? So, this dream skips past all of the moments in San Francisco and goes straight to a situation where I'm in my old apartment in Hollywood, the one I showed y'all. And as I'm in there, I find myself in a situation where I'm in there with my mother, and I guess it's a carryover from the moment before, where I still have the problem. I'm still going through my mental health stuff. And, you know, she gets a phone call from my stepmom. And my stepmom asks her something along the lines of, did you take on the responsibility of somebody's conservatorship? I don't know how to say that, but like, when someone is in need of support, right? And someone takes over their business and takes over all their circumstances. I don't know how to say that words, but it's something like conservatorship or something like that. And she said yes to my stepmother. And then my stepmother said, okay, well, that person's responsible for Robert Williams. As in Robert Williams from the Celtics who just got traded to the Portland Trailblazers. And it was like, okay. And my mom, like, listening to her say that, and she was essentially saying to my mother, Robert has locked himself out of his apartment and is going through a mental health thing, but he's in the Bay Area. And it's like, okay. And my mom was like, all right, well, I can't get to him because I'm in Hollywood. So I'm going to have one of my friends, I don't remember who she said, Larry, pick him up and get him to the hospital. When from there, we needed to try to get to the airport so we could get it back up to the Bay Area, try to see what we could do for Robert, right? Weird dream, I'm telling y'all. When my mom got into the car, my mom started having a real serious mental health breakdown. She stopped being despondent. If you ever heard me speak about my mother's moment where she kind of had a mental health situation where she was kind of laying down in the bed and it decided to like knock out as if she wasn't alive. She had stopped breathing for a couple seconds. I told y'all about that and it really traumatized me. And then she ended up waking up doing like a little, like just like a one of those, and then woke up and then kind of was kind of despondent. This was like a long version of that, but she was driving. And as we're driving down the street, leaving the apartment in Hollywood, she just stops being herself altogether, man. She starts driving crazy like I was in Oakland. But it was scary because I was trying to explain to her that, you know, we're trying to get somewhere and you're going to hurt somebody driving this way. And she was driving barely okay. Like, she ended up almost hitting some people. And I ended up saying, "Mom, what's going on?" She was just losing it completely, but not in a way that would like be like frantic, but more so like she was kind of going into like this type of energy, like as if she was just, "I don't care anymore." Sort of like what I saw that day in real life. It was almost like she was just, "I don't care anymore what happens." And I'm like, "Mom, you love your son?" And she couldn't say she loved me anymore. I'm like, "All right, she's going through it." It wasn't like I was panicking, but it was like, "All right." And she was driving kind of crazy and just slow, but almost as if she was going to hit somebody. She ended up driving towards some cops, almost hit them. They didn't pull her over. So, you know, it was a dream. I knew I was asleep, but I also understood that I was dealing with a mental health situation with my mother. And she was having a mental breakdown. And it was one of those situations where, like, I was trying to wake her up. So I kind of slapped her down near her stomach area and said, "Hey, you were in a real, you know, you're not acting like yourself. You still believe in the Holy Spirit, right?" And she kind of looked at me like this. And she went, "No." And then proceeded to continue driving. I'm like, "All right, my mom lost her mind for real." So I'm like, in my head, I didn't think, "Let me try to drive," for whatever reason. It was more so, "Let me try to wake her up in whatever way I can. We're going to get her to a hospital because she's having a complete mental breakdown." And I was like, "Mom, I love you." And she was like, "Okay." Like, she was really, really, it was almost as like she was completely drugged out of her mind with a real downer type drug. And from there, it got to a situation where, you know, I started getting angry with her because she was basically driving as if she wanted us to not make it. Like, she was trying to drive off into stuff and I'm trying to grab the wheel and trying to keep it sturdy. And I was like, "Look, you ain't about to kill me because I'm going to see my kids. And don't you want to see your grandbabies?" And she kind of snapped out of it, kind of like, "Yeah." But then she went back into it and said, "No." And then she kept driving. I'm like, "Yo, this is not my mother, obviously. But even more so, we have got to get her to a hospital." But whatever was in my brain didn't say, "Okay, we got to stop the car, get her out, put her in the driver's seat, and put me in it." It was more so like, "I can't get her out of the driver's seat. She ain't going to move. She's going to end up crashing the car. We try to do that." So I was just trying to help steer the car and trying to keep her awake. And it was a situation where some lady ended up kind of walking in the middle of the street. I guess it was a crosswalk, but she was crossing it in a way that she shouldn't have been. And then walked up to a car that was near our car as we were driving forward. I guess she was trying to get something out of the passenger seat of someone else's car in the back behind the driver. So as we're driving by, their car is next to ours and she's walking in front of our car. My mom was not going to stop for her, so she almost hit this lady. The lady kind of like got bumped by the vehicle, but not quite ran over. And I was like, "Mom, you're going to hit this lady." And she just was like, "Don't care. Like, I don't care." I was like, "Yo, this is wild." And one of those situations, I was, you know, from that moment, I hit her on her stomach again. Like, I was like, "Wake up," like trying to like wake her up. And then she looked to turn to say something to me. I'm like, "Forget this." And I woke up out of the dream. Like, I just said, "Let me stop this nonsense." Because I already knew I was dreaming. But it was like I was trying to help my mother. You know, I was trying to get her to realize that she was in a very serious mental space that went all the way left. And I was asking myself, I'm like, I wonder if she's going to ever be able to come back from this. it was weird because it was almost like the panic that I actually would have had in real life wasn't there. It was like I'm looking at her and I'm like, okay, I know she's not well. When she said she didn't believe in the Holy Spirit, when she said she couldn't love me, then I realized I'm dealing with something that was much deeper than anything I've ever seen in real life. But it was almost like the idea was that she wasn't actually dead in real life. You know what I mean? It's like, this is a dream, but my mom is still around and she's having a mental health thing in the dream. And I guess I care to see the dream through. It was one of those type of weird things, but once it got to a point where the dream was too much for me, I'm like, let me wake up out of this. And so I wanted to document that as best I could. There was more to the dream before that Oakland moment where we were in McDonald's. There was some more to it, but the most important part was sitting there in the car with my mother as we're trying to get to the airport and seeing her completely lose her mind in a way that I had never seen in real life. But to a point, reminded me of that moment that I had reminisced about on this camera a couple of times. So I wanted to document that because a lot of times during these circumstances, being in this hotel, I've had some really, really serious dreams, man, where my mom has been in the dream but hasn't been like herself. And I told y'all this a couple times, but none more serious than this. This was like a demon, like a real demon who had jumped into my mother's body and was going to basically kill us in her car and maybe kill everybody else if she could, you know, that kind of thing. And no matter how much I tried to wake her up with different keywords that I knew my mother would react to, it wasn't reacting. It got to a point where I started getting angry. I'm like, okay, this isn't my mom, but I still gotta be able to survive this. And she's going to keep me from living to see my kids. She's going to keep from seeing, living to see my grandkids. And so that was really the dream, more or less. It was anger. And it was understanding that this was not her in there. This was not her spirit in there. It was just something that was trying to pretend it was her, more or less, to give me a nightmare. And to be honest with you, I wasn't fearful. I was angry. I wasn't fearful at all. I was pissed off. But, you know, I wake up feeling okay. I think, you know, this takes me to something that has nothing to do with the dream. But since I believe that thinking about this last night may have kind of prompted whatever this was in some way. But as I was meditating last night before I went to sleep, you know, I was thinking about just the timing of everything. As I told y'all, I'd been documenting timing specifically, and I want you guys to go check out that video because it was kind of strange. It was only a minute and a half, but I told y'all about how I'd been connecting with my friend Kay, and every time we had over the last couple days, it would be 11-11, 1-1-1 on the clock, you know, 4-4-4. It's just been a lot of that we've both been noticing. And in praying about that, I found myself meditating on the word alignment. And then I started thinking about kind of the circumstances from which I'm here. And I was going to make a video about it, but I decided not to. And, you know, I went to sleep. But I could segue into that. I know this video didn't hardly make any sense, but me trying to recall dreams and you waking fresh up out of them, I didn't give myself a chance to think about it. So bear with me. But we're going to something else. So, I may have said this once before, but probably not within the last 3 years. So none of my followers probably even know what this is about. But so myself, my mom and my dad, how they met. The story that was told to me was my mom's cousin, Ethel, had passed away. And just to give you a backstory, I guess my mom and Ethel were pretty close. And Ethel lived down here in L.A., somewhere in the L.A. area. I'm not really sure. But, you know, once my mom moved to L.A., she became close to Ethel. Was able to see Ethel a lot more than she was back in the day. I don't really know how that goes. But more or less, Ethel had passed away in her home. I don't remember from what. Natural causes, I don't know. But my mom was actually the person that went to Ethel's house to be with Ethel. when, you know, after she had passed, my mom went there. I don't really know how the story went. I don't know if anybody else was there or not. I don't know. But my mom went there and Ethel was, you know, it was sleep to not wake up, you know, on the couch. And my mom sat with Ethel and prayed over Ethel and was just kind of at peace, you know, that kind of thing. And my mom met my father at Ethel's funeral. Ethel was my father's co-worker in L.A. I don't know where they worked. This story is, it hasn't been told to me since I was about 11 years old, but I remember it very, very much, but not details. But that's how that went. My mom and my dad at the funeral, and it turns out that my mom's father and my dad are both from the same little town in Oklahoma, Watonga, Oklahoma. So I'm not sure how many people live there, probably less than 3,000, 4,000. It's a small town. And through that connection to Watonga, they were able to have some synergy, some understanding about one another, something to get along with. I don't know how to say that, but that's how they connected. Like, you from there too? Yeah, my daddy's from there, that kind of thing. And it turns out that my grandfather, my mom's dad, and my dad's sister, who are also are the same age, were actually high school sweethearts. For like 3 years, they were in a full-fledged relationship. And, you know, they're still alive today. My BB and my granddaddy, they're still around. But they kind of, my mom and my dad actually kind of connected, like, oh my God, so y'all really know, like, you know my family, that kind of thing. And because of it, you know, I was the birth of that. Like, that's what came of that situation. They ended up having me a couple years after that. So what ended up being the case is, obviously, I'm the person who connects a couple families in that little town. Now, I've only been to that town a couple times, not for any length of time. They usually have something called Watonga Day. Had a lot of fun there. I think the last time I went down there was like 1995. It's been a very long time. But that's kind of the connection that ultimately brings me together to be who I am. It's that little town. All of my family's from that town. And you know, you look at that situation and, you know, as I was meditating on that, it came to me to share that with Kay because of all the timing stuff that's going on, because of this coincidences that's been happening in regards to her brother passing away and how that situation was. And then ultimately finding that her brother and my mother have the same birthday and are also buried in the same cemetery in the same section. Coincidentally, my mom passed in 16, her brother passed early this year. So it's like how they end up together, how they end up having the same birthday at that. I don't believe the cemetery does that. You know what I mean? Put people together who have the same birthday. That's not how that works. This is just sheer coincidence. And Kay has been struggling with that. You know, her struggling with her brother's passing. That's what really she's been dealing with. And as I was meditating on that, what my circumstances was, it was put in my heart to share that with her. Like, you need to let her know this, because it will help her heal. It will help her understand what I'm doing there. That's essentially what the Lord told me. It'll help her understand that what she's going through, she shouldn't agonize over, because good things and miracles can take place based on what it is she went through. Tell her what your mother went through, and then tell her what came of it. And then tell her where help remind her where your mother is now, and use the word alignment. Tell her about the timing, you know what I mean, of things, how Ethel lived her whole life, passed away. My mom was able to, from the love that she had for Ethel, be present at her funeral, from which to meet the husband that ended up being the person who gave her only child. And that person is connected to her by way of her family, and all these different alignment things that ultimately I come about to be. And when I left those messages on IG, something came to me and said, you've given the Lord something. Those were the words that came to you. You gave God something. You have given me something. That was the energy that came to me. Like, you've given me something.
I'm like, God, I can't give you nothing. You have everything. He was like, no, but you've given me something. Those were the words that came to me. And then when I went to sleep, I ended up having this evil dream, more or less. And I wake up, and here I am talking to you. That's directly the sequence of things. I don't know if there's anything to that at all. But what I do know is the odds of me being here, based on all them circumstances being as they are, like me winning a lottery. I probably shouldn't be here. And if I should be here, it should be because those folks met in Watonga, Oklahoma, definitely not in LA. And if they were to meet, it shouldn't have been in a situation like this, right? Like, the odds aren't very high. And I just remember talking to Kay, and she was telling me in the dreams that she has about her brother isn't himself. When he comes into the dream, it's almost like his spirit ain't necessarily who he is. And she ends up having to deal with a different version of him than what it is that she knew in real life. That's kind of what happened to me. It's definitely what's been happening to me in my dreams. And the dreams that I've documented, not just the one I just had, but the ones that I've had in this hotel room. Not in this room, but even in the other room, but in this building, have kind of been like that, to where I've been dealing with a version of my mother that wasn't her. Almost as if a demon's been hopping into my mother's body in these dreams and pretending to be her. It's just a lot of parallel in that. I knew my mother to be a woman of God who always told me that the Holy Spirit was my comforter. So when I asked her if she believed in the Holy Spirit and she looked at me like she didn't know what I was talking about, I definitely understood that wasn't my mother in that dream. It was her body. But it was something entirely different inside of her that was trying to pretend to be her, to scare me. And that understanding, for which I had in the dream, angered me, because I had already understood all of this. I don't know what's going on in regards to what the Lord is doing, but I know, as I always tell y'all, it's spiritual warfare. I do understand that I'm having a lot of dreams, specifically for the reason of I'm not smoking weed. Usually when I smoke weed, and I've told you this a million times, I'm a regular weed smoker. I don't be having dreams at all. My brain, that part of my brain that has dreams, gets cut off when I smoke. So I'll go long periods of time without ever having any dreams. But since I've been on this side of town, I've smoked no marijuana, none. I haven't bought any, nothing like that. So I've been having dreams often. Every night is something very vivid. But this was probably the most vivid dream I've had since that horrible anxiety attack that took place about 4 weeks ago in my dream, where my mother was also part of the dream not being herself. But this one was different because I had a lot more strength. I wasn't fearful in this dream. I was just simply sad watching my mother go through that. Like, okay, she's losing it. I'm not sure if she's gonna be okay. I felt happy to a degree that I was older going through this. Because when I went through that moment that I referred to at the beginning of the dream, I was a child, and it scared me very much. I thought my mother had passed right in front of me, when actually she was just having a mental health breakdown right in front of me, or something that we never really actually found out to the extent of what it was. But this was just an extension of that, a much longer, drawn-out extension of that, picturing her getting in the car and then driving around with us both in that mindset. That's what this was. And I just feel like I've been, you know, attacked spiritually, probably for what it is that I did last night, and sharing that for which I just told y'all about myself and my mom and dad meeting with Karen, who, according to what the meditation that came to me, was something that the Lord very much wanted her to understand or know of, to refer to in regards to trying to heal. Lord was like, she's going to be able to help heal from this information you're giving her. It's going to help. She's going to understand the alignment of timing from birth to death, to circumstances that the Lord can use through death. It's like a sequence that can help her heal. Maybe even you as well, if you understand it to be what it is I'm trying to express. And it's like I gave the Lord something, allowing him to connect with people through bereavement in a different way by way of my story, for which I never looked at it like that until probably last night. But it's true. Like, my cousin passed away, And then from there, my mom was able to meet my father and have her only son, for which she loved very much. And my mother passed away. And she ended up finding herself in the same place where my friend Karen's brother passed away. And hopefully some healing can be said of that. Hopefully some good can come of this story. Not to say that me and Karen are going to have a child or nothing like that, but I don't know what the Lord wants to do. That's the point. The point is, he wanted me to share that story. And in that dream, it seemed that my mother was trying to keep me from living to see whatever that story is going to be in regards to myself. And I kept saying, I want to see my child. I want to, you know what I mean? That kind of thing. And it just, you know, the mental health aspect of the dream would not shake. It went from me having a mental health concern in Oakland to Robert Williams having a mental health concern, and we having to go up to Oakland to get to him, to my mom getting in the car from there, losing her mind completely, trying to get to him. It was a lot of mental health stuff. So I just know that ultimately this comes down to mental health stuff within myself. With these dreams and all this stuff I'm having, with my friend Kay and how she's dealing with her sadness and her bereavement, it all comes down to a lot of mental health truth. It needs to be addressed on top of the spiritual aspect of things that must be addressed as well. And I just see a lot of parallels. I see a lot of parallels between myself and the Karen, based on what it is that we're experiencing in our dreams with our loved ones who've passed, who happen to be buried with one another. And something's telling me that her brother probably experienced some timing things as well, some things that would kind of make this align even further. If I were to know his story, he probably would have some things in there that would just make this make even more sense. I document everything I go through. A lot of it, one would probably think, is just in my head. But sometimes the things that are going on outside of what's in my head align with that, like the timing of things and stories that happen with other people that come back around to my very own story. And that's what helps me have the opinion that there is a higher power in place helping guide me through these different things that I'm referring to, guide me through my own mental health struggles and the stuff that I deal with internally. I wake up this morning feeling very poised telling you this, even though I know most of it is very hard to follow, especially the beginning of it. But at the end of the day, I am a miracle based on the improbable circumstances of my existence, based on the likelihood that my mother and father probably would never meet, and if they were to meet, probably not here, probably not under those circumstances. And then I just look at the timing and the sequence of my mother's life, and just to fast forward all the way through years after she passed, and how there is still alignment and timing and various different coincidences that the Lord is using through her and where she is to affect what it is that I'm experiencing in my life right now. And I just understand that that timing is aligned from birth all the way through. And so that's the word that I left with Kay after I left those messages on, you know, telling her about what came about there and myself. I left one word and it said alignment, the timing of alignment and various different things that the Lord is trying to do is all within the clock. As I tell y'all, it's timing. If you want to know of God existing, it's in the coincidences of life and in the timing of things from which they happen. What I also understand is the enemy will do the same thing. The enemy too will try to get involved with the timing of circumstances, and if someone's open to being used by the enemy by way of the clock, he will too use those people. You know, what came to mind for me was last night in the video that I had vented about, I said that I felt like the enemy was using Karen more so than God was. And as I meditated on that last night after leaving the information out there, I continued to meditate before I went to sleep. The thing that came to mind was timing. You know, it's the timing of her absence that's also aligned with the sadness of my circumstances, feeling abandoned. It seems like she's gone at the right time. It seems like when I'm having the worst days, I never am able to communicate with my friend. And it's like that is something that is being used. The enemy is using that timing no different. And she is saying good morning right now. Good morning, Kay. I'll hit you when I'm done with this video. But the enemy is using her to not only be present at the right time, but to be absent at the right time. And during those times when she's absent, according to her, when we're communicating, she's often down. It's a depression that's keeping her from wanting to speak to anyone, reaching out and speaking to anyone. And I'm like, that timing is not by accident. That is the enemy attacking her at the right time to make sure that she's not around at the right time to be the friend that she needs me to be. And I'm willing to bet that the enemy used me the same way back in the day when I was away from certain people, to attack me to make it so that I felt like being isolated at the exact moment they needed me to not be. They needed me to be present or what have you. And I just understand it a bit differently as I wake up this morning, that alignment. And so this is what I come to you with, man. Make sure that your spirit is right. What I was doing back then that would otherwise allow me to be aligned with the wrong thing was just different stuff that ultimately people do on a regular basis. Lusting around, thinking evil thoughts, being selfish, letting my mind be clouded by weed, not drugs necessarily, but weed and stuff like that, sinning and all of that. It can make for you being used by the enemy. And in that can be a timing thing that ultimately pulls you away from people you need to be away from circumstances that are meant for you, pull you away from who it is that ultimately loves you the most, make you feel like you need to go toward people you have no business going toward. And in that timing, a lot of damage can be done whether you're present or not. In that timing, both the Lord and the enemy can use you for various different things. So if you're aligned with the Lord, then you'll be on his timing. If you're aligned with the world, you will be on the enemy's timing, doing all types of evil stuff, secular stuff, leading people astray, cheating people and all that. You can be on the enemy's timing. It's all in the clock. So that's what I've come to understand. As she's been over there dealing with what she's dealing with, not to say that I know she's in sin in any way, but you know, whatever the case may be, she has been shown God's timing by way of all these different alignments that we talked about. Every time I talk to her, it's 444-141. The Lord is clearly trying to show her something in that timing. But by way of whatever it is she's got going on with her depression, or what I would think is depression, going through bereavement, and what she does naturally within those moments, it often brings her away from not only myself, but as she said, away from others that she needs to be around in certain situations. And I think that that is aligned with the same type of timing. When you are the spirit of the divine, you're either going to be used by the Lord or the enemy in regards to time. If your spirit is aligned, not everyone is spiritually inclined, not everybody probably this is relevant for. But for those who are supposed to be used by the Lord in whatever way, if your life is on divine timing, like my mother's was, like I believe her brother's probably was, like Ethel's was, like mine is, if you align with certain timing, then you got to understand that this is what I'm finding it is. This is how that works. You're either going to be on God's timing or you're going to be on the enemy's timing, but you're always going to be on timing. Because what it is that your example is in life is supposed to align with someone else through life and death. And you, the Lord is still going to be using you and your story to bring other people to various different circumstances and glories and various different alignments. No matter what you're doing. You know, the enemy and the Lord, unfortunately, it almost as if they align congruent, if that's the right word. They almost like... Either it's me or you in regards to the devil or God in regards to using people by way of the clock and showing examples by way of the clock. So we just got to keep our spirit right. We got to get rid of certain things that don't align with what the Lord wants us to be about, his timing. And I think the earth will coerce you. And what I mean by the earth is the various different things that you see in the world, you know what I mean? In our society, it's entertainment business and stuff. They're trying to keep us on low frequency and stuff like that. We talk about a lot of different things that we see. That's about keeping people on either off timing completely or on the enemy's timing in a lot of cases. And we got to get some of those things out of our lives so that we're not used the wrong way, so that we're not seeing the wrong things. Because everything is connected, is what I'm telling you. And for those who are suffering you know, the ills of someone passing and bereavement and things like that. I just want you to remember this story here. Remember what it is that I've told you here. Life can come from those circumstances, even if it seems like it's the worst thing in the world. The timing of which those things take place could ultimately align with 10 times more happiness, 10 times more life than what that death can ultimately provide. I think of my mom's entire life and some of the things that she's experienced, only for her to pass away, to be in the exact right place so that this story can make sense in regards to her brother also being there as well. It's like, that ain't got nothing to do with my mom, but all the things she prayed in her life, all the things that she did in her life, she would never have known. It was never meant for her to know that her story was still being told. No different than Ethel's in regards to her passing away so that I could be found. You know, my mother and father could be made so that I could be made, found so I can be made. You see what I'm saying? So they can meet. Ethel would have never known that. Ethel was never to know of Brandon, but it was her passing that ultimately made it possible for me to exist. So, like, just understand it, that the sequence of life and death will still bring forth fruit in life for others, and that your story is still being told even well after you're gone. And you still hold purpose even after you're gone. Even after you're well into your grave, years after you're in your grave, the Lord will still use my mother in this case and Karen's brother to help us receive the timing and the understanding and the wisdom of such things that I'm speaking to right now. And thus, me being able to give them to you through this camera, which I know can reach so many more people than that. I told y'all, when I first started this camera, I was looking for proof that the Lord exists. I didn't want to preach to nobody nothing. I started seeing the things that the Lord was doing in my life, and I felt it was important to start showing the world what I'm seeing so that it wouldn't just be me telling stories, but that y'all could see this stuff. And that's what this has all been about, and I've learned a lot through this process. Not only that God is existing, but how he operates. And then from there, he's unfolding the understanding that, you know, there are other things to learn beyond just knowing that he exists. And you've seen all of this on these therapy sessions. So I just want y'all to kind of bear with me if you're watching this video and you don't quite understand what I'm talking about. I understand that I was a little choppy, fresh waking up out of this dream, a fairly traumatic dream with my mother basically not loving me and not believing in God, and then from there trying to kill myself and others in the car. But I understand that I've been attacked, because when you do what it is the Lord wants you to do, you're aligned in such a way to tell, you know, to allow the Lord into your heart, not sinning, not doing nothing but meditating on helping yourself and others, particularly others. And that meditative voice more or less tells you that you've done so. Yeah, the enemy's going to have a reaction to that. Yeah, the enemy's going to jump into your dream, try to attack you in your dream. But if you're aligned, all you're going to do is wake up and attack him back by getting on whatever your timing is and continue to do what your mission is. For me, it's to do this, talk to y'all. He didn't do nothing but give me content for my channel. That's it. And ultimately give me more wisdom in regards to not only knowing why I should continue to stay on the path I'm on, in regards to staying away from certain sins and keeping my spirit strong, but also to understand that the Lord is still telling my story. So I need not jump off of timing. I need not try to initiate my own passing. I need not quit on life, because the Lord is still trying to do certain things with my existence that may not have nothing to do with me. And in this case, I feel like he's trying to help you guys through what it is I'm saying, and Karen through what it is she's going through, so that she can heal and then from there continue to stay on the timing that he wants her on, rather than the timing that allows her to be a sword for the enemy. And that's what came to mind, you know, through the timing of things, the enemy's using her as a sword, pulling her away at the exact moment necessary so that I would be at my lowest point, you know, for myself, looking at it that way. You know, it's almost like I'm a weapon of the Lord against the enemy, and the enemy's using her as a weapon against me. But I fight that with love. You know, it's not that we fight that with the energy of where you at, why you ain't been there. It's more so speaking life into her, like I told you I was doing, showing love to her in different ways, continuing to respect myself enough to tell her, hey, I deserve to be treated better, but to also understand that she's in mourning and she's going through what she's going through, and that whatever's in my head is no good. That would be fighting that weapon the wrong way. It's a chess game. It's chess, not checkers. So when you're dealing with evil, you can't fight it with evil. When you deal with evil, you fight it with love. And that's how you defeat that enemy. So it's more so like, yeah, you may be trying to weaponize her against me, a weapon of the Lord meant to destroy you, enemy. But what you haven't realized is that I've taken that sword from you. Like, you don't have that. I've given that to the Lord. So whatever you thought you was doing to use her to do whatever it is that you were trying to do on the timing that's not of God, you need to realize that we've intercepted that weapon. And there will be more that we take from you. You will not be able to effectively win this war. So that is spiritual warfare for you in a nutshell, as far as I can tell. Always remember the concept of when you're fighting against evil, you can't fight fire with fire. You're not going to be able to do that. Love is what's going to ultimately take from the enemy what the enemy's trying to take from the Lord. Forgiveness and those type of energies is ultimately what's going to help you. And if you're getting attacked in your dreams, just remember what it is that I'm telling you here. Enemy wanted me to wake up feeling all sad and all fearful and thinking of my mother in different ways and worried about her spirit as if she's not in heavenly peace when I know better. I already know what that was. I don't have to think any of those thoughts because I'm aligned with the Holy Spirit, and I know my mother was aligned with the Holy Spirit by way of what it is the Lord is still doing right now. So I don't have to wonder if that was her spirit in that dream being despondent and ultimately not believing in God, because I know God and I know my mother. You understand what I'm saying? The reason why I don't feel my mother around is because she's in heaven. The reason why she ain't coming to me and bothering me in these dreams is because she's too busy enjoying the spirit of Ethel in her presence at this time. But they're watching me from afar. I know they got my back, but they don't need to be present showing up in dreams with their real spirit too often, because it isn't necessary for the alignment of what it is that's going on in my life. And when I do need my mother, she often shows up. I'm often feel her presence. But rarely do I do, because I have that Holy Spirit, for which is my comforter. It's a truth that she gave me in her life, and it's a truth that I find to be the case now, long after she's gone. And through meditating on the Holy Spirit, I come to all of these conclusions. I come to the confidence to bring these to you, and bring these to Karen, and bring these to anybody else that would otherwise hear. So that's what I have to say, man. Keep your alignment with the Holy Spirit. It is your comforter. Do not align with the world's timing, because you will be a sword used against good in the war against good and evil. And remember, God is found in the timing of things, but so is the evil one. So align yourself to the best of your ability with the right timing. Alignment. BDR44, I thank you all for watching.